Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK, and today I have the pleasure of sharing with you some awesome tips and modifications you can do to your brand new guitar to make it that little bit more awesome. So you've already got a new guitar, that's fantastic, you should be stoked to bits. You should be very happy with how it plays and looks and sounds because you've picked it, you spent your hard-earned money, or got it as a gift, on this awesome new guitar, and it'll be fantastic. But there are certain little things you can do to improve your overall guitar playing experience. These are the kind of things that I've picked up along the way, I've been told, I've discovered for myself, so I'm gonna save you all the time in the world and tell you them in this nifty little video right here. And with that as well, if you wanna add anything or expand on anything that I talk about, please comment down below and share the love, because it's a lot of fun talking about these fantastic little stupid bits of wood and metal. That's enough chatting, let's get into it. I will say off the bat, some of these tips are universal for all different kinds of flavors of guitar. Some of them are more model specific. So if your guitar has a certain feature, a certain spec, that's for that. Doesn't work on other ones. Also, some of them are free. Some of them are inexpensive. Some of them are a bit expensive. I'm trying to cover a lot of ground here just to try and make your life a little bit easier. And again, like I said, expand on anything by commenting down below. Also, not setup related. This isn't gonna be setup related. That's a whole video completely. I can put a link in the description box down below talking about little setup tips and tricks you should look out for when getting guitars and getting your new guitar set up perfectly. This isn't gonna be a video where it's gonna be like, oh, to intonate your guitar, do this, it'll make your guitar play better. That is a big part, but that's not what this video is about. That's enough rambling. The first thing I wanna talk about is simply strings. Now again, some of these little tips and mods will be obvious, some of them might not be so obvious. This seems quite an obvious one. Strings, when it comes to getting a new guitar, ideally, the guitar will be strung up and it'll feel fantastic under your fingers, no matter what kind of size, shape, or style it is. However, a fresh set of strings just brings everything to life. Like, because if you've got a nice new American Fender, wonderful new American Stratocaster, wonderful thing, fantastic thing, the strings, the play is beautiful out of the box. Strings can wear out even if you're not playing them. And that guitar has been on a flight from America all the way to, well, the Netherlands, here in Europe where they're based, and then to the UK. Those same strings, they will still play and feel fantastic when you pick them up, but a fresh set of strings can totally revitalize a guitar and breathe a new kind of lease of life into it. And you can just obviously get the regular strings out there, like the Daddario's, the Ernie Balls, the Fender branded strings, but if you want to be a little bit, if you want to step up a little bit, you can get fancy strings. And by fancy strings, just like Blue Peter, I mean things like coated strings and long life strings, like Daddario do the NYXLs, which are fancy steel that's been hardened in the under Thor's hammer and stuff. Really long lasting, get the XTs, which are the coated strings. Elixirs are long life strings. Ernie Ball do the paradigm strings, which are unbreakable. There's a few different levels of strings. Obviously, if the strings are fine on the guitar and you don't want to spend a little bit of money, that's totally fine. But if you really want to kind of, I don't know, start fresh with a guitar, with your new guitar, a new set of strings, it's a great little easy modification to kind of gel with it that little bit quicker, if you kind of know what I mean. Even if the strings are fine, it's just kind of nice to, I don't know, gel with your guitar a little bit, whether you go for regular strings or the fancy long life strings. Again, I'm not saying buy new strings with every new guitar you've got. The strings will be absolutely fine, but it's a fun little tip and trick to mod your guitar just when you get a new guitar. Next up, we have something still to do with the strings, and that is to stretch them in. A lot of people think that strings need to be played in, and that is still very much the case, but it's a lot easier to stretch your strings in. That kind of loosens them up and makes them stay in tune that little bit quicker, longer. It just kind of settles them in quicker as opposed to them having to just sit on your guitar. And the way in which you stretch your strings in is simply tune your string to your desired pitch, like E standard or E flat, like this is right now. Then give it a bit tug. Hope you can see in this camera right now. Don't rive it, because you will pull the string out of the bridge or snap it and stuff. Just a little kind of, all the way down the neck, just a little bit of a tug. You can get little mechanisms and machines to do this, but super easy. To give it that bit stretch, then the string will naturally be flat. You'll tune it again, it'll be like, it'll sound like flat. All you do is tune it back up again to your desired pitch, stretch it again, and it will still go down in pitch, but it won't be as flat as it was before. It'll be a bit closer to that original note. And then keep stretching, keep tuning up, keep stretching, keep tuning up on all the strings until the note doesn't really deviate from that original pitch. So you get the pitch, stretch it, it doesn't go flat that much, tune it back up, then your string is nicely stretching. Don't overdo it. You can overdo it if you want. You're not going to break anything as long as you don't pull too hard, but that's how to stretch your strings and make them settle in that little bit quicker. Next up, we have a little tip for the guitars that aren't Floyd Rose equipped. So the guitar I was just playing had the metal locking nut that locks everything in. This is for your more traditional guitar with a regular nut. And that is, before you restring your guitar, lube your nut up. So, it's a funny thing to say, but where's my nut lube? You can get these wonderful little syringes from people like Dunlop. Big Ben's nut sauce is also a great one. You can also use Vaseline if you want to lube your nuts. Or yeah, it's like a little applicator, and you simply put a tiny little bit of this slippy lubricant in the nut of your guitar. Again, a tiny bit. You can put more in, it won't make a difference. You put lots in, it'll just get everywhere. So just a tiny little bit in each of the grooves of the string. Obviously, when the strings are off, you can probably slide it in with the strings on, but like, these little wonderful little things right here allow the string to glide smoothly through the nut, so it doesn't get snagged on any tight nuts. It's ridiculous all of this, but yeah, you know, if, like, even if you think the strings don't move back and forth in the nut, they do. So I know this has got a bridge on right now, so it will be moving back and forth, but when you do bends and stuff, that bend's gotta come from somewhere, right? And it will be pulling on the string, therefore pulling it from the tuning peg up through the nut. And when you release it and go back to your original, you want it to go back to where it originally was. And if there's lubrication at the nut, that will help everything slide back to its original pitch and make everything back to, well, where it was. Some people swear by this, some people don't like it. It's a totally free world and you can do what you want. You're not gonna break anything by not doing this. You're not gonna change the world by doing it, but this is a small thing. If you do this with the other little bits and bobs to kind of improve your guitar tunability, it all builds up and it does make a difference. Speaking of keeping your guitar in tune, whether you're a pro, whether you're a beginner, it's just the ball game of playing guitar is keeping everything nicely in tune. These little tips and tricks, like I said, do help, but there's a few different ways to keep your guitar locked in tune, minus the locking tuner, the locking nut on the Floyd Rose guitar I was playing before. The first upgrade you can make to the guitar, if you want to kind of lock everything in place, this helps with any kind of strat trem, keeping everything in tune, and that is locking tuners. These lovely little things on the headstock. These are expensive. You can get cheaper ones, but I would always recommend if you're putting something on a guitar that locks everything in tune and you don't want it to break, get a brand name like Fender or Goto or Spurzel or Daddario, do the clip lock ones. Don't buy cheap copy ones because they might break and that's your guitar out of tune completely forever and you've wasted your money. So always spend a little bit more and get some proper locking tuners. So all these little guys do right here is have little wheels on the end. I'm not going to slacken these off because the string will come out the top. So little wheels on the end. And all you do is thread it through the hole, then clamp it down. So these strings haven't even got one wind around the tuning pegs. They just go through, tighten it up and tune it up maybe half a way around. And that keeps everything in place, locked in at the back. So again, there's not a lot going on. There's not a lot to move. There's not a lot slipping and sliding when you're playing guitar. Ideally keeping everything in your desired pitch. Now, if you don't want to buy locking tuners, I do have a hack for locking the string in place around the tuning peg. I spoke with this in a number of different videos. I think I got it from Joe Bonamassa, not personally, from watching a video of his. And you can actually lock the string in the tuning peg without having any locking tuners. Now, hopefully you can see from the close-up of my SG tuning peg on screen right now, notice there's two winds around the hole that the string is going through of the tuning peg. So you put the string through the hole. I always do one wind over the top first, of the hole, the string in the hole, and then one wind under the bottom. And as you tighten it up, it naturally, the tension nips the string in place and kind of nips it down, locking it, essentially locking it in place. And this is, like I say, kind of like a faux locking tuning system. It's not exactly the same, but it does nip it in and it's ideal. Also, I can't stress enough, the less winds you can do around the tuning peg, the better. So you might be thinking, let's put loads of winds on to really nip it in place. That is ideal, one above, one below, because metal strings expand and contract with heat. And the less metal that's around the tuning peg, obviously put enough on to lock the string in place. Don't like put half a wind on because your string might actually just fly out. The less winds, the less metal there is to expand and contract, the less metal to kind of press against each other and change, because this is to an extent a malleable material. The less there is to change and alter, therefore altering your pitch, the better. That was very wordy. Hopefully it made sense, and that's locking tuners and how to pinch the string in like your own little special fancy locking tuner. Now moving on from tuning it and going into playability. Now I'm gonna talk about the modification of overwrapping your strings over a stop bar tailpiece like I have on my Antiquity right here. You might see loads of people with Les Pauls do this. Some of them only do it to certain strings in the bridge. And check it out, I'll show you what it is. So as you can see, the overwrap is wrapping the strings over. So putting the strings, instead of through the tailpiece this way, then over the tunematic bridge, you put them through the other way, wrap them over the top of the tailpiece, and then over to the headstock. Now, as you can see there, the whole point of this is to reduce the break angle. So there's less of an intense angle from the stop bar up to the tunematic. And that in turn releases some of the tension on the strings to make them a little bit slinkier and to make them a little bit more manageable. So you can bend a little bit further and you can have a little bit more fun with some of your crazy licks, tricks and shreds and whatnot. This isn't for everyone. Some people don't like this. It sounds and feels just as awesome without this, but it's a funky little trick to try to kind of make your guitar feel a little bit slinkier. It doesn't massively change it. It doesn't change the world. It's just a slight little difference. And you can notice going back and forth between overwrap and your traditional wrap of your stop bar. Say if you want to play with thicker strings or you go up a string gauge set to like 11s or something, and you do find them a little bit too thick and clunky, that certainly won't make them feel like 10s, but it will give you a little bit more give and a little bit more slink, if that makes sense. Definitely worth giving at least a try. Next up, we have quite a niche modification and trick for guitars with tremolos. So these springs in the back. And I'm gonna try and pick up on my little lav mic right here. These little springs can sometimes cause reverb and like a ring out echo. Hopefully you can hear that. It's not the reverb through an amplifier, similar to a reverb through an amplifier, but the springs vibrate due to the nature of you hitting something next to it. They vibrate and kind of ring out. People don't like that sometimes. I'm not really massively keen on it, but there's a super easy way to get rid of that. And this kind of ring also comes from certain guitars that have big tailpieces and whatnot. You might see folk in studios put little foam earbuds under this part or wrap electrical tape around the strings up here and the strings down here to stop any kind of vibrations. It's the same thing. So the strings only vibrate between the bridge and the nut, but when you physically hit the thing, the springs in the back can vibrate and the strings can vibrate past the bridge and pass up to the tuners. And as you can see, the super easy way to stop the springs from ringing out is to simply get some tissue paper or a soft cloth and press them up against the springs in the back, either seal them behind the back plate of the guitar or stuff them in underneath. This won't affect the springs at all. The springs will still rock back and forth as long as you don't jam it in between all the little links of the springs, but this will stop any resonant and any ringing and make the string ring pure. You can also get little bits of tissue, like I used to pull the end bits off cotton buds and actually stick them down inside the spring. That does it as well, because I like having the back plates off my guitars. That's one way of doing it. Doesn't particularly bother me, that spring noise, but some people it really annoys. So that's a little tip and trick to get rid of any excess reverb. And like I said, if you have got a guitar where it's ringing up the top and below the bridge, just get some, a little piece of foam earplugs or something just to kind of stop it all off. That's what, when you see old guitars recording in the studio, that's what all that foam is in there. It's not just for decoration. Now next up we have a trait which annoys many, many guitar players out there, but it's actually a really easy fix. And I get asked about it all the time, about how it doesn't happen to me. And that is, that's not really doing it, but neck dive, especially on SGs, Thunderbirds, Jazzmasters, and stuff like that. That's where the headstock of the guitar, the body weight on the guitar is actually pretty light, and the headstock, there's a lot of wood here from the neck onwards, can sometimes, I'm doing a little bit of dance right now, go down the way, and people don't like that. People like the guitar being up here as it is, and I'm a huge SG player. I love my SGs so much, and that neck dive doesn't really bother me to an extent, but a great way to solve it, a super easy way, is to not get a strap like this. Do you have these kind of like woven nylon straps or the straps that kind of look like seat belts and feel like seat belts? Because they're naturally slippy. Up against your lovely clothes, they will slip. Even with a non-neck heavy guitar, if you push a guitar down, it will slip down right, it'll slip right down. Great solution for that. Super simple. All you have to do is get yourself a nice leather or suede strap. Now, this is a new strap, so I haven't put it down and I feel like I've never had my guitar this high in my entire life. It's very easy to play though. But notice how it's not moving anywhere. Now this is just straight up a leathery straight suede strap off the shelf. You can get them for not a lot of money these days. You can spend a lot on a leather strap, or you can spend a little bit. But if you don't want any neck dive, get one of the ones where it's kind of rough on the inside. So let's get up close there. So I have the suede straps. So it's nice and shiny one side, the other side, bit rough. This kind of rough material on the inside, as you can imagine, sticks to your clothes and doesn't let the guitar neck dive. It's as simple as that to fix all your neck diving woes. Next up, let's talk about the guitar that you actually touch more than anything, and that's the neck and the fingerboard. The first thing is to get rid of scratchy frets. A lot of the times with more affordable guitars, you might notice the frets are a little bit scratchy when you do little bends and stuff. You might notice a little bit of like kind of scraping and scratching. It might not necessarily come through the amplifier, but you'll be able to hear it and feel it, feel the grittiness under your fingers. This doesn't mean the guitar's broke. This does not mean it's a bad guitar. You often just find this on more inexpensive guitars because polishing frets takes a lot of time, and for the price of the guitar, they just want them out the door of whatever factory, and that's kind of how they end up in certain stores. Super easy to fix this. Super easy to fix this. So many companies out there make little fret polishing kits and stuff, like Dunlop do a great one, as you can see right here on screen. They have the little fret collar, so that goes around the fret, so you don't damage any of the wood around it, and the thinnest grit sandpaper you've ever seen. And all you do is cover the fret and gently go back and forth, and that smooths the fret down, so it feels like a brand new fret. And that, in essence, is polishing the fret, getting rid of any of that scratchiness. Super easy. It takes a little bit of elbow grease and a little bit of time, but that's all you do to get rid of that scratchiness and make a guitar feel like $1 million, even though it might have only cost you 99 quid or something. Sorry, I have just got to say, that's not just for affordable guitars. You can find it in affordable guitars. Some affordable guitars are great. Some expensive guitars have scratchy frets. It is literally just the way in which it comes out the factory and who's been doing what that day, but it's a super easy fix. Also, if your guitar is quite old or hasn't been played in a while, or say your grandfather has given you a 1959 Les Paul that he found in his attic, you very lucky bugger, it might still have scratchy frets because it's been oxidizing in the air and everything's kind of, all the sweat's kind of dried and it's all a bit scratchy and a bit gross. This fret polishing stuff totally gets rid of that and make it play brand spanking new. Or in this case, better than brand new. Another awesome but super easy tip you can do to get your new guitar playing even better is to moisturize the fingerboard. Now this is really just for, we'll say, non-maple fingerboards. So non-maple, roots for rosewood, Indian laurel, pau ferro, that kind of thing. We've all seen dry fingerboards before, and if you haven't, that's what a dry fingerboard looks like. The wood is looks very thirsty, like it's dried out. It doesn't look very soft and malleable like rosewood is supposed to, or pau ferro or Indian laurel. It's a super simple fix. All you do is get some lemon oil or something of that nature. Everything is linked in the description box down below. Squirt it on the fingerboard, lovely massage it into the wood. It'll be hydrated more than it's ever been hydrated. It'll thank you by letting you shred all your way through from your local pub and club gigs all the way through to Wembley Stadium. It'll be very thankful for you. Once it is hydrated with the lemon oil or fingerboard moisturizer from Dunlop or Kaiser or Gibson or wherever you want to get your stuff from, you haven't got to do it all the time. Just do it when your fingerboards are dry. When it comes to oil and fingerboards and stuff, don't do it every time you change your strings, because you can overhydrate your fingerboard and it can get a bit wet and a bit, the wood can warp a little bit if it's too wet, but a little bit of hydration goes a long way, and it looks a lot better as well. A hydrated fingerboard does look the bee's knees. Next up is a little tip and modification for the guys and gals that think that there might be something up with the guitar. It's not sounding as pure and as awesome as it should, or you might just want a little bit more from your guitar. And that is to raise the pickup height. So if the closer the pickups are, pickups are magnets and they pick up the vibrations due to witchcraft within the pickups, the closer they are to the strings, the more the magnetic field is picking up the vibration, therefore the guitar will be louder and give you a bit more grunt. Some people want more, some people want less. So it's super simple to raise and lower the pickups of your guitar. Whether it be a single coil or a humbucker, the two little screws up top either side of your pickup simply raise and lower that side of the pickup. Some people like to have closer towards the strings on the treble side as opposed to the bass side, and vice versa. I like to keep mine pretty straight, but yeah, it can make a world of difference raising your pickup higher or dropping it down into the body. It is totally your call and up to you. There's no right or wrong way. It's just got to sound right for you. Now next up, we have a super easy modification that'll make a world of difference to the way in which you play guitar, and that is by adding strap locks to your pride and joy. So regular straps just have a little hole in. As you all know, the strap goes over said hole, but it can't come off very easily. There's not a lot of force involved. So you want to do guitar spins, your strap's going to end up in your next door neighbor's greenhouse or something. So yeah, very, some people are fine with this. There's nothing wrong with not having strap locks, but I highly recommend getting strap locks. So all strap locks are, there's so many different variations out there. There's Dunlop, there's Daddario, there's Schaller. Schaller are my personal favorite. I've used Schaller for years. I got my Kramer right here. They come in two parts. So one part clips to the strap. It's normally a little kind of mechanism which locks it in, and you simply replace the butt. The other half is the bit you use to replace the button on your actual guitar. And there's, a few different mechanisms in which you can lock them in, but on a Schaller, all you do right here is there's a little kind of hook thing in there that goes over the nubbin, locks in place. Now that isn't going anywhere. Guitar spin for as long as the day is long. All you do to get it off, pull the little lever on the top, that releases it, and then unhook it from its little sheath. As easy as that, and it's an absolute lifesaver if anything, God forbid, were to happen to your guitar. Like if you were to drop your pride and joy, you don't want that. These change the game. And they're relatively inexpensive to get as well. They do cost like maybe 20, 25 pounds or something, which for the size of them is a lot of money, but you don't want your fancy guitar or your pride and joy guitar hitting the deck, do you? So it's a must have in my personal opinion. Next up, the last few is gonna be a little bit niche, like guitar specific almost. And now I'm gonna talk about back to tuning, like how I started this little video. If you have a guitar with say a Maestro Vibrola or a Bigsby Tremolo, and you're rocking something back and forth like the Bigsby or the Maestro over your traditional Tune-O-Matic style tailpiece, sometimes like with a nut at the top of the loop I was talking about can get stuck. The string can get stuck grinding back and forth through those little, the little saddles in the bridge. So like I said earlier in the video, the whole aim is when using the vibrato or bending a string, it's make the string return to its desired position, its desired pitch. And if you're going back and forth over a bridge, the string is literally moving back and forth over that piece of metal, and there's little places where it could get snagged, it could get stuck, no matter how much you stretch the string in or lock it up at the tuning peg. A good little modification, again, a little bit of money, is to replace this with something like a roller bridge. So roller bridges, as you can see from the picture up there and from what I'm holding right now, are pretty much exactly the same. They have the same kind of functionality as a tune-o-matic bridge. However, instead of it sliding over a nice knife edge of a saddle, there's simply a little roller, allowing the string to glide back and forth, roll when you play with the tremolo or play with the pitch of the guitar. It rolls back and forth smooth over that tune-o-matic bridge, making it again, ideally return back to its initial position. And last but certainly not least, a little modification you can do to your guitars with a tremolo, either double locking or a regular tremolo, but you will find this mod mostly in Floyd Roses, and that is to replace the block at the back with a big brass block or a titanium block. Now, it's quite an easy DIY mod to do. Just take everything to bits with a Floyd Rose, replace the block, and put everything back together like the way it was before. So, as you can see, this is your standard tremolo block. Again, nothing wrong with this. It worked fine for Eddie Van Halen and stuff back in the 80s. Great, it doesn't really change the way it functions, but when you add more mass to the bridge and more volume, if that makes sense, you get a little bit more sustain, a little bit more kind of, there's a little bit more there, there's a little bit more girth to the note. At least that's what we're led to believe. And we feel it in our heads, and that's the way guitar players work, because we just want things, if that makes sense. But yeah, I wholly believe all my guitars with Floyd Roses have the big brass block in. I wholly believe it does make a difference. I think that's it. But if you stuck around this long, that is absolutely awesome. All the little individual bits and bobs and products I've spoke about are all linked in the description box down below. Check them out at pmtonline.co.uk. If you want to add anything, please feel free to share the love, have some fun. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to us here at PMTVUK for more awesome guitar music related content. We are playing music today on social media. I've been Dagan, and I'll see you next time.